Majesty, authorities, organizers, and distinguished colleagues. It's a great pleasure for me to attend and be invited to the 7 CAAN conference here in the beautiful Valencia. And I'm very honored to give a key lecture here on Alzheimer's disease. And I will try to focus on the development and our knowledge about the disease and how this knowledge can help us to really detect the disease, understand the disease, and hopefully also treat it more efficiently in the future. I would like to mention a little bit about Karolinska and Stockholm and the activities we have. And we have a center for Alzheimer research. And this center is a hub for Alzheimer research within the Karolinska. And they cover a lot of different types of research, from very preclinical cell studies up to investigation in patients. And we have different locations for these new buildings for these type of research. And there are three different divisions that are mainly focused on preclinically as well as clinically. And also we have an aging center for epidemiology studies in Stockholm. And those units are very closely related to our memory clinic at the Karolinska Hospital, and we have a clinical trial unit as well as geriatric care research unit. And you can see here very roughly how many people, it's about 170 people, 200 people, and you can also see the proportion of different professions. I also wanted to mention that our memory clinic has a catchment area. We are situated in the south of Stockholm. We are also now building up a clinic on the north. And in the south, we have about 600-700 new referrals for memory assessment every year and 5,000 visits. And you can also observe here that the age of the patient are quite young, mean 63, and also the cognitive impairment is quite mild. And you see here a proportion of the diagnosis for the mean for the last 3 years. And you can observe here that the diagnosis of the diagnosis of Alzheimer is just 20%, but you observe that mild cognitive impairment as well as subjective memory impairment are a dominating diagnosis. And then, of course, we also have some more less rare disorders. For the memory assessment at a memory clinic, generally we are doing imaging, and the GP has already done computer tomography and taking blood samples. And at the memory clinic, we also do neuropsychological testing. And also something that is probably quite special for Sweden is that we routinely do a measurement of cerebrospinal fluid biomarkers and thereby measure the amyloid and the tau. And we also have, and I will talk more about that, about positron emission tomography, that in unclear cases, we can also measure amyloid and also the glucose metabolism. And the importance for early detection is, of course, that we want in the future to intervene very, very early and perhaps even at risk and not at symptoms, as we probably are today. And I would like to start and going back with Alo Alzheimer, Dr. Alo Alzheimer, who described the first cases for Auguste Dieter, who showed to be hereditary forms of Alzheimer's disease when it was investigated finally quite recently. But what he described was not only the presence of the amyloid plaques and the tau, but he also mentioned, but that was not in his first report, inflammation, astrocytosis. And I will come back to that. That might be something that is more important than we have thought before. An important question is, of course, when you are talking about Alzheimer's disease, why do some people develop Alzheimer's disease and some not? And this is not today, I think, a simple answer, even if you know that there are risk factors. But you can hear on the slide, you can observe and look at Madame Colmore, who is considered to be the oldest woman in the world. She reached the age of 121. And she had trosis, she had difficult to hear, she had difficult to see, and she was sitting in a wheelchair, but she had a perfect memory. And when they asked her, how you can be so old, she said, I've never been bored. And I think that is a very important question if you now consider those who reach a very high age, that they are looking forward. They are not depressed. They are very interested in the world, and I think that is something very important. In the middle, you see a president who also developed Alzheimer's disease, but at a very, very high age. And then on the right, we have the Frau Dieter, who has hereditary forms, and therefore she had a risk for developing the disease, a high risk. Presently, we are quite aware of that if you consider neurodegenerative disorders, a main feature is in the brain some deposit of large proteins. And we call it proteinopathies. And you can see here on the left, you see the brain, and there are different diseases, and they are affect different parts of the brain. But interestingly enough, if you look upon the right here, we can observe that there are several diseases who have the same protein. If you, for example, look about tau, which you will hear more about, you can observe it's not only Alzheimer's, it's Parkinson's disease, there are other forms of what we call tauopathies, and the beta amyloid, which is a characteristic for Alzheimer's, is also found in Parkinson's disease, in Lewy body disease, and so on, and even in ALS, which you will hear more about later today. So if you just focus now on Alzheimer's disease, that is a complex pathology, and we still are focusing on the understanding of the amyloid plaques that are outside the neurons, and they have the tau, which will be a little bit more difficult to study, at least in patients, because in the brain, because it's intraneuronal, inside the neurons. And we also have astrocytes, that is a non-neuronal tissue, and they are the largest number of cells in the brain, as well as also microglia. And they are considered to be some sort of supporting the brain. Something that has been very important is that it has been possible to move from solely pathological studies at autopsy of brains, as Alzheimer did, to studies in vivo in patients. And you see here the example here for the left, which I mentioned, the pathology, and here indicate that we today can measure amyloid in the brain. We can measure tau, we can measure astrocytes, and we can also, of course, measure the size of the brain and the atrophy. And here we have to realize that we probably are not measuring the same thing, because here it can be 20 years, 15 years between the first symptoms of the disease and at autopsy in the final stage of the disease. And some of these pathological changes are changes continuously, and some are quite constant. So an important question is, what is the time course for these pathological processes, and how are they related? And you see, just looking upon this slide, that with the color here, you see that there are different distribution in the brain with the amyloid, almost all of the brain. And you see the tau, which is very much in some specific areas, like here, the temporal cortex. And we have the neuroinflammation and degeneration, and I will come back to this. So for those who don't know about the positron emission tomography, I will just mention that that is a technique that is different from computer tomography and magnetic resonance tomography, which is given information of the structure of the brain. Here you can measure the presence of different proteins, and you can measure the function of the brain. And it's depending on that one inject the isotopes with a very short half-life, which is bound to a compound that is assumed to bind, for example, to the amyloid plaques in the brain. And this isotope has a very short half-life, from 20 to a couple of hours. And then this positron PET camera then measured the distribution of these isotopes in the brain and can give you pictures and also absolute values. So here you see the distribution of the amyloid plaques in the brain. And all red or yellow and green are amyloid plaques. And we did the first studies in Uppsala in the collaboration with Pittsburgh University with a compound that is called PIB. And in the first patient, we were surprised that it was so much of amyloid plaques in the brain. And also in areas, if you look here, down here, also in the frontal cortex, where the patient didn't have any symptoms. So it's almost distributed in the whole brain, in areas which is not still, is not affected by the disease. And this type of investigation has shown importance in a patient with quite early symptoms of the disease. And we have a diagnosis that we call mild cognitive impairment that you can observe here is something between Alzheimer and normal aging. And mild cognitive impairment is just describing that you have some effects on the episodic memory, and it doesn't need to be to lead to Alzheimer, but it's very important if one can detect changes already here in the spinal fluid and in the brain. And to just give an example how important this type of investigation is to discriminate with MCI patient, patient with mild cognitive impairment, who will develop Alzheimer's dementia or not. We can look upon the first two rows here. And the upper row here is a patient with a mild cognitive impairment. And the investigation here shows that there is no amyloid in the brain. We just see a binding of this compound in the white matter. And you see a quite clear differences with the patient in here in the middle, where there is a lot of high uptake in, for example, the frontal cortex, but also the temporal cortex. And this patient has been followed, and this type of group of patients with amyloid are followed, and they convert to Alzheimer, while those who don't show amyloid in the brain do not convert. And you can also observe here that the patient with amyloid looks approximately the same as an Alzheimer patient with the dementia diagnosis. So we know that it takes about 20 years, as shown here on the left on the top of the figure here. It takes about 20 years to increase the amount of amyloid in the brain and to develop Alzheimer's disease. When we have amyloid plaques in the brain and have the diagnosis of mild cognitive impairment, then of course the cognition goes down, but the amyloid plaques becomes quite constant and is not so much increasing. There is also a correlation between what you measure in brain and in cerebrospinal fluid, and that is important because to use biomarkers measurement in the cerebrospinal fluid, as I mentioned, as a routine, is much cheaper. And this is an example of a European collaboration with many centers in Europe, where we analyzed more than 300 samples. I can see that, especially when we measured in the CSF the amyloid, what we call A-beta-42-40, two forms of amyloid, and make the ratio, there was a very good correlation with what we measure in the brain. So these are the red here is pathological, and these are the normal up here. There has been three different types of these amyloid PET tracers developed for most used in the clinical setting. And still we can conclude that they are not yet used so much in the routine. And this is because that the assurance company has to approve this type of imaging in for assessment of memory disorders. So there has been several initiatives. And in US, assurance company decided that they should pay for the assessment of patients during memory assessment for an amyloid PET investigation. So it was planned that there should be 18,000 patients included. And within, I think it was 1.5 years, one managed to investigate more than 11,000. And in Europe, we have a comparable initiative that is called MEPAD, which is a European Union project. And the aim is here to investigate 6,000 patients. And there is a diagnostic study where we add amyloid PET as a tool in the normal investigation to investigate how important is it to early know whether there is amyloid in the brain. And you can see here the centers that are participating, and Barcelona is participating here, together with also, as you see, centers in France and in UK, in Holland and Germany and Sweden. This is a study that is ongoing, and the patients are included. The American study was just published, the IDEA study, 11,000 patients, and it was concluded that the management of the patient was changed in 60%. So there was a significant effect of this type of early diagnostic marker. And in the US, there is some reluctance to perform CSF sampling. So therefore, probably this type of imaging will be more used. And you can observe that in those patients who showed mild cognitive impairment, it was about half that show amyloid. And in those who were demented, there was 2/3. And something that also was important is that the use of drugs to treat cholinesterase inhibitors, memantine, was increased in those with amyloid positivity. I also mentioned that we have also presented from Stockholm a study with approximately 207 patients. And here you see different diagnoses. And the red and blue here shows the red is presence of amyloid. And to the left, you see the mild cognitive impairment patient who were assessed. And these are only patient who had an uncertain diagnosis. So they have already done CSF biomarker analysis, and it was those where this analysis was not quite clear, where there was an imaging with the amyloid measurement. And about approximately 50% of the mild cognitive impairment, they showed amyloid, and the Alzheimer, it was about 2/3. Which indicate that there was patient with the diagnosis of Alzheimer who in fact was not Alzheimer patient. And there was another explanation or another type of dementia. So on the right, the bars, you see that for those that we call early Alzheimer prodromal and Alzheimer's disease, almost those had amyloid, and those with other type of dementia, there were no amyloid. In this case, the diagnosis changed 44% in this type of uncertain cases, and there was a significant increase in the treatment of the Alzheimer patients with different type of cholinesterase inhibitors. If you then turn from and leave Alzheimer, sorry, amyloid, and turn to tau, this slide illustrates the differences in the distribution of amyloid and tau. So on the top, just some schematical showing that figure showing that amyloid is almost in the whole brain, as I mentioned before, while the tau is much more specific and very much started in the temporal part. And you see it also here in the PET studies with amyloid, almost all the brain, while here the tau is very specific in the temporal cortex. One can follow the development of tau during the progression of the disease, and the pathologists are talking about different Braak stages. When we are in the Braak stage of 5 to 6, it's an Alzheimer's disease, and you can see here how the red is increasing here, the yellow is increasing, which is more tau. You also can, in the bottom, see different stages of Alzheimer's disease. MCI with amyloid, we call it prodromal stages of Alzheimer and Alzheimer's disease, and the red and the yellow is increasing in Alzheimer's disease, but still also a patient with mild cognitive impairment show significant amount of tau. There are different types of Alzheimer, and this slide just illustrates how tau can be distributed in different forms of Alzheimer's disease. So for example, we have here a very special type of Alzheimer's disease that we call the logopedic form. It's a form that you have problem to find words, but you don't have any problem with really to manage your life and to plan your life or thinking. It's the words that you have difficulty seeing, but it's not from some type of frontotemporal dementia. And you have also the here down the more the behavioral type, and you see that the distribution, the red and yellow here in the brain are different. So this is the for the logopedic, the very typical in the temporal cortex, in the temporal cortex here. An important question is then, how does this start? What comes first? What is more important? We know that tau is present even at very young age in young people, but it's very low amount, and in healthy subject there is also some tau. And there is a difference with the amyloid plaques, because they are not present normally. And it's speculated that when amyloid is appearing in the brain, so if you here have some tau, here in the temporal cortex, but when the amyloid is starting, in some way it starts also the tau to get it more distributed. So you see here that the blue is traveling and spreading more in the brain. So this is one of the theories today, that tau can initiate, but probably is not the most important for the cognitive impairment. And if you study follow-up of patients, so this is a 17 months follow-up of a group of patients who have been studied with tau. You can observe here that if we look, for example, about here, the Alzheimer patient who have severe forward AD dementia, after 17 months, it increases the amount of tau. Here it becomes more red. It's more red than in an MCI prodromal, and it becomes yellow, which is much more tau. So there is an increase. Even after 17 months. We can also conclude that when we're talking about tau and the possibility to measure that as a biomarker in brain, we still are at a very early stage. This type of research started approximately 2014.
So it's just 5 years. So we are aware of that we still don't have the right instruments, and we try to find out what is the best. And what is also a complication or a very interesting phenomena is that tau is not only present in Alzheimer's, it is, as I mentioned, present in many other neurodegenerative disorders. So it might also be possible that we have to develop tools that can distinguish the different forms of tau and study them for different diseases. This is an example of some patient who, at the same day, were receiving two tau tracers. And they belong to these tracers to what we call the first generation. And what we can look upon the left here and the middle, we see that the color is totally different. And here, it's probably not easy to read, but these are different regions, and we can see just for the bars here that they're totally different. And this indicates that these two tracers have different properties, and the middle one has turned out to be probably more important for other types of tauopathies than Alzheimer. And it here follow very much the regional distribution with amyloid. An important research is also to study postmortem brain tissue. So this is nothing that we are leaving, because there one can also study these tracers and see how they are binding in postmortem brain tissue. So what you see here is quite unique. These are whole sections, half hemispheres of a human Alzheimer brain. And these sections has been incubated with different tau PET tracers. And you can observe here that the tracer that I mentioned was in the middle and was a tracer that didn't bind so much in Alzheimer. It also, when it's used in postmortem brain tissue, show a difference in binding comparison with a couple of others that are, and one was also used in the study that I showed before. And this gives us important information. So presently, there are available what we call the first generation of PET tau tracers, and there is a second generation. And there is a great hope for this second generation, because they seem to consider to be more specific for Alzheimer's disease. And there are also a possibility, as I mentioned, that it can be developed tracers that can distinguish between different type of tauopathies. And it's sometimes very difficult to distinguish and to understand different forms of, for example, frontotemporal dementia. There are also more basic research ongoing, and the structure of tau has not been known. It was just a couple of years that the electron microscope structure was described in Cambridge, and that make it possible to calculate the different binding sites of these tau tracers on a tau fibrils. These are some studies that we have performed in Stockholm. And what is interesting, these are just computer in silico measurements, suggesting that there are four binding sites, as you see here. And one can, for different tau tracers, then calculate that they are binding different to different sites. So you can, for example, see here that these are some of the, what I call the second generation. One is most binding, the blue here, to the third site, one to the first site, and one to the second site. And it is a little bit different from the first generation. It has not yet been studied in patients if there are differences. So these are totally new research and ongoing research, but I think it's important. What is important with tau is that it correlates better than amyloid plaques to cognition and to atrophy. And this slide shows a study in the brain where one have correlated episodic memory, which is the most typical for the early stages of Alzheimer's. And on the top here, you can observe that there is a correlation between measurement of tau in the brain of different patients and the episodic memory. But if I really look upon different regions who are involved in this episodic memory, one can observe that measurement of tau gives you just some few regions. You see the blue here. But if we instead measure the glucose metabolism, which is more reflect the neurons activity, you see that it's much more red distributed in the brain. And this study shows that probably tau is not directly correlated to cognition. It is mediated via the glucose metabolism, via the neuronal function. So it might be possible that you may have tau in the brain, but it is not directly and immediately resulted in changes in cognition. So there is a complexity with tau, and I have said that there are different tau tracers with different selectivity, there are different binding sites, and there are also relation to different pathology. I will also mention about inflammation. And I mentioned that Alvar Alzheimer, he described that, but he didn't mention that in his first paper, and there is a question why he didn't do that. And astrocytes is very important because they seem to have some controlling function of the neurons. Therefore, it's important to study them. And we know that in Alzheimer's disease, there is a change in the astrocytes. The first to be what we call an hypertrophy in the early stages, and then there is a degeneration. And we decided to try to measure, when we have succeeded to measure the amyloid, we tried to see, could we measure also the astrocytes, which are around, for example, the plaques. And we used a compound that is called deprenyl, which is a monoamine oxidase inhibitor. And we know that monoamine oxidase is present in the astrocytes. And I was expecting that the largest amount of astrocyte that we should measure should be in the Alzheimer patient. And this is an example. We also had patients with mild cognitive impairment who has shown amyloid in the brain or have not shown amyloid in the brain, and we had also a group with controls. And the most surprising was that there were more astrocytes in the mild cognitive impairment patients with amyloid and not in the Alzheimer. And that indicates that what we measure in the living patient in astrocytes is an early phenomenon. So the next step was to went to studies in subjects who belonging to families with genetic mutations, what we call autosomal dominant Alzheimer's disease. And we have some families in Sweden which we have longitudinally follow, and some members of this family are carrying mutation and some not. And they are participating from age of 30 years of age and up until 70, and they don't know whether, most of them don't know that they are carrying the mutation, but they do this for scientific research. And what we could observe was that in those who were carrying the mutation, and this is illustrated in the slides, that the amyloid was more higher in those who had symptoms for the disease in comparison to before symptoms. But the astrocyte measured with this deprenyl, or DID as it's written here, was lower in symptoms. And you see in the color here, it's less yellow than in here. And the glucose metabolism, which reflect the neuronal function and the nerves using of sugar, that is lower, of course, in those who have dementia. So this slide illustrates very clearly, if you look upon, and it might be difficult in the back to see, but here we have the axis of minus 20 years, until so this is 20 years until expected onset of the disease, here is 10, and here is 0, and here is 10. And we can see here that the amyloid in different subjects is increasing, These are those who don't carry the mutation. It's quite stable. They don't have any amyloid, very low binding. And on the right, you see the astrocytosis, the increase of astrocyte, where in those who are carrying the mutation, you see the highest is approximately 23, 24 years before onset, expected onset. And then it goes down here, it's quite flat in the non-carriers. But interestingly enough, I can observe that it's also a variation in non-carriers. And I know that other type of disease, like depression and such things, might influence. And we know that it's quite tough to be a member of this type of families. So this slide shows the differences between someone who's carrying a mutation and not carrying a mutation 10 years before expected onset of Alzheimer's disease, and the increased binding here of this compound deprenyl, which affect increased in astrocytosis. And you see here the differences here with much more red. These are all as an increase in astrocytes, and you see it's much less in a non-carrier. We have also done some collaborative studies together with Professor Fortea and his collaborator at Barcelona University, where they have, by structure measurement with MRI technique, magnetic resonance imaging, speculated that there is a change in the cortical thickness and what they call the diffusibility very, very early in autosomal dominant carriers and in early stages of Alzheimer. So we analyzed also in collaboration with them our MRI, so there was structural measurement, and found that there is a correlation. So we can here observe that when we have an increase in cortical thickness, we have also more of astrocytes, and the diffusivity goes the opposite way. So this is also a way of measuring, I think, this type of changes of astrocytes. We also know that there is a positive correlation between glucose metabolism and the astrocytosis. So to the left, there are patients who have been measured with both astrocytes and glucose metabolism. And to the right, you see that there is, in individual patients, there is a correlation. So in very early stages, as I mentioned, 20 years, the glucose metabolism is high, because it's not the neurons is not so affected yet. There is no symptoms. And the astrocytes is high. So we are up here. And then it goes down. So we can speculate that for astrocytes, there are time courses from the beginning in the early stages, reactive astrocytes. It's speculated that the astrocytes are eating up the amyloid, trying to eat it up in the early stages. And then the astrocytes become more end-state astrocytes. And this is also related to the time course of the other pathological changes that I've been talking about, where the increase in amyloid is the earliest, and probably tau is coming then, and the glucose metabolism is later, as well as the degeneration. So it is possible with what they call multi-tracer studies, study different type of pathology. And you see here an example of patient, and both in early stage, what we call prodromal, as well as in more Alzheimer's dementia. And all this pathology has been measured in the same patient. And we see differences in distribution in different parts of the brain. We can observe that the amyloid, as I've mentioned, is quite unchanged with different stages of the disease. The tau is increases, the metabolism goes down. It's more yellow here than red here. And the astrocytosis is opposite, with more astrocytes in the early stage of the disease. So it's possible to formulate this type of curves. And we have here the astrocytes as probably a very early marker. And I also mentioned the microglia, which is also another forms of glia cells, and it's speculated that that also might have changes in early stages, and that has to be investigated much more. So for diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease and to detect it early, I think it has been very important, the studies and the definition that has been formulated by Professor Dubois from Sapeche in Paris, and this is represent a publication where this type of biomarkers was introduced, and the presence of amyloid in CSF and in brain was suggested stands for, in MCI patient, prodromal Alzheimer's, an early stage of Alzheimer's, and that can be recognized and probably also started treatment. And very recently, the NIA, National Institute of Aging, in a working group, defined a new framework, and headed by Professor Clifford Jack, and that is what is called the ATN criteria, which defines the presence of amyloid in the brain, the tau, and neurodegeneration. And it's based on measurement in CSF, cerebrospinal fluid, and in brain. And there can be different combination here. You can have amyloid and not tau. You can have neurodegeneration and not amyloid, and it's not Alzheimer. These 18 criteria is discussed a lot, but it's still not used clinically. It's considered to be a research criteria. Then, of course, the future, and what many people wishes is that you can go to your GP and just take a blood sample measurement and see if you have amyloid in your brain, and it reflected in the measurement in the blood. There has been just a recent year some studies ongoing, and just a couple of weeks there was an editorial in JAMA Neurology saying that the blood markers for use in Alzheimer moving from if to how. And of course it has been published some studies showing that you can see that there are some differences here, especially in Alzheimer patients who have amyloid in the brain, that it's lower amyloid in plasma compared to healthy controls. However, I still is a little bit skeptical because I look upon the individual subjects, and there is a variation both in controls and in Alzheimer. So, but I think it probably might be as the Netherlands group here also published a paper, they suggest that this might be something for a screening for drug trials. And what they think is an advantage is that you take this blood sample, and if you have changes in amyloid, you can do a CSF and an amyloid, so you can reduce the number of patients in a clinical trial. And there is also some studies indicating that if you have changes in plasma of measurement of amyloid in the form of 4240, that it might indicate that you in the future might develop amyloid in the brain and Alzheimer's disease, and that is also something that probably can be used for including patient to treatment. So I will end up here with just a few comments about what is then the future of Alzheimer's disease treatment. We know today that we have, since many years, some drugs, cholinesterase inhibitors, memantine, which are used and trying to keep the patient not to deteriorate so much, so quickly. But we know that it's no cure, it's just a symptomatic treatment. We also have learned that, and we also advise our patient that different lifestyle factors is important. So prevention and risk and detection are probably very important all issues. And it's important to be active, to use the brain. We know that it's the daycare centers is very important. This can all help to slow down the progression. If you look upon drugs that are specifically targeting the pathology of Alzheimer's disease, you see here a summary that has been made of all candidates, and you see there is a lot of candidates, And they are in different stages of phase 3, phase 2, or just in health subjects. And many of them are supposed to have a disease-modifying effect, and there is also dominating on amyloid. But many of these has failed. And if you look upon what has been considered now 2019, the proportion of those who are in a quite large clinical trials in phase 3, you can observe that one third is on the amyloid, to reduce amyloid. And very few, just a few percentage, is on to reduce tau and tau immunization. Unfortunately, regarding the attempts to reduce amyloid in the form of immunization, has more or less, in many cases, antibodies failed. And there has been a lot of different type of antibodies. You can observe them here, which should target different forms of amyloid, both the small forms of amyloid and a little bit larger, that is called the protofibrils or the plaques. I can mention that we still cannot measure these smaller forms. They are very difficult to measure in the brain, that is, and hardly not in autopsy brain tissue, because there is no good antibodies. There was, I hope, that an antibody that is called aducanumab should help. And there were some promising results published in such a distinguished journal as Nature. And it failed. It doesn't show that there was any cognitive effect. So what is left is one antibody that's called BNN2401. And it's in phase 2. And it will take some time to 2022. So until then, I think we have to work very much with lifestyle and activation and the present drugs. And if we just make a summary of drug strategies, we can think about primary prevention. That should be when you are totally normal, and there we don't have any biomarkers. It might be that some blood measurement might be the future. Secondary prevention, it is more when you can measure some pathologic changes in cerebrospinal fluid or in brain. And slow progression, and that is, of course, in prodromal Alzheimer and Alzheimer. So I think for the future, we should be positive. And I think we can foresee that there will be a lot of development in the field, and there are a lot of activity. And I think it's very important with increased understanding how we can detect and how we can understand the role of different pathological processes in Alzheimer's disease, and that will lead us to a therapy in the future. I'd end up, of course, with a lot of people who have been involved in my research, and thank you very much.
By doing the BRCA stages, the old method by using tau antibodies. And now when you do with the new methods, looking with PET tau, there is not an overlapping. There is some quite differences. That difference, in your opinion, are because in one case you are looking for phospho-tau and in another case for something else, or why is your opinion about the difference between old BRCA stages and new BRCA stages?
I didn't go into detail, but I mentioned that this postmortem brain studies are very important also for development of these tools, this tau tracer that we should measure in the living patient. And it shows that there are different, exactly as you say, there are differences that this antibody, they don't really reflect everything that you measure with these tau tracers. I showed that there were different binding sites on these oligomers, tau oligomers, or the fibrils, and the antibodies is more directed to one. So, although there are some different types of antibodies, for example, against tau, but and I can also mention that it's not only tau that shows this complexity, it's also for amyloid, and there are different types of binding sites on these amyloid fibrils. For example, it has interestingly been shown, we have shown it in studies, that if you look for an example of different type of mutation of Alzheimer's disease, the traces that are used now for clinical measurement of amyloid, they bind differently to different forms of these different types of mutations that we have. So there are different binding sites. So it's quite complex. And of course, BRAC stages is probably, we have to see that you can measure it much more in detail than this staging, because there is not so, there is a quite narrow phase between no tau, for example, and when you have a lot of tau and it's BRAC stage 3, 4, 5. So I think we are just in the beginning, but I think the most important is that we have opened the possibility to study the brain and of course also the cerebrospinal fluid, it's also interesting with this plasma studies that we have to learn much more, but we have to be careful. I also think we have to be very careful when we measure things in healthy subjects. There I think we have a different view in Europe in comparison to US, where in US one consider that if you have some amyloid, if you have a low beta amyloid in CSF, this is Alzheimer. It will be the Alzheimer. But we notice that sometimes there are many explanations why you have this amyloid, and one shouldn't always be certain that it will be developed of Alzheimer's disease if you just have a measurement of one pathology.
Okay, if there are no more questions, thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you.